In the circuit shown, we're going to find all the branch currents using one of the most powerful tools in circuit analysis, nodal analysis. This circuit features two voltage sources, but notice, no current sources. Now let's pick this point as our reference node. Looks like the voltage source isn't directly connected to it. That means we don't know the voltages on either side of that source. And actually, no matter which node we choose as ground, one of the voltage sources will always be floating, disconnected from ground. That's where something interesting comes in. This setup creates what's known as a supernode. Sounds intimidating, right? But don't worry, it's not as tricky as it sounds. When we encounter a supernode, we treat the two nodes on either side of the floating voltage source as one big node when applying Kirchhoff's current law, or KCL. That clever move lets us sidestep the whole issue of not knowing the current through the voltage source. All right, let's take it step by step and solve this circuit together. We'll be using the standard 8-step method for nodal analysis. It's logical, easy to follow, and once you get used to it, it's a breeze. And hey, if you ever want a quick refresher, we've got a full tutorial linked in the description. Here's the game plan. We'll find the voltage at each node relative to a common reference point, usually ground, by applying Kirchhoff's current law. Once we've nailed down those voltages, calculating the branch currents becomes super easy. Ready to dive in? Let's get started. First things first, we need to label all the components and values in the circuit. If they aren't labeled yet, now's the time to grab your pencil. But lucky for us, everything here is already nice and tidy. So step one is already checked off. Moving on to step two, we identify all the nodes in the circuit and choose one to be our reference node, also known as the ground. So what is a node? It's any point where two or more elements, like resistors or sources, are connected. And here's a quick tip. If two points are connected directly, without anything like a resistor or voltage source in between, they count as the same node. Now take a good look at the circuit. How many nodes can you find? Go ahead, pause the video and count them. Got it? There are four. Next, we need to pick one of those as our reference or ground node. A smart move is to choose the node that's connected to the most components. That usually makes the math much cleaner. In this circuit, I'm going with this one right here. It connects to a voltage source and two resistors. That's a solid pick. But here's the thing, don't overthink it. No matter which node you choose as your reference, your final answers, the branch currents will come out exactly the same. The only difference is how the equations look while you solve. With the reference node chosen, we're ready to keep moving forward. Next up, assigning voltages to the other nodes. We always begin with any voltage sources that are directly connected to the reference node. These give us node voltages immediately. In this circuit, we've got a 10-volt voltage source, and its negative terminal is connected directly to the reference node. That means the positive terminal must be 10 volts higher than ground. So the node connected to the positive side of the source is at 10 volts. Simple as that. For the remaining unknowns, we'll call them V1 and V2. These represent the voltages at each node relative to ground, the reference point we picked earlier. All right, with all node voltages labeled, we're ready to roll into the next step. Now it's time to assign current directions and voltage polarities. If we had current sources, we'd start there. But in this circuit, we don't have any. So we move on to the resistors. Let's label the current flowing through each one as I1, I2, I3, and I4. Now here's something cool. The directions you choose for the currents, totally up to you. Just make a guess. If you guess wrong, your calculations will spit out a negative value. That just means the current actually flows the other way. But one important thing, once you pick a current direction, make sure your voltage polarities across each resistor match it. That keeps everything neat and consistent when we start using Ohm's law. All right, let's keep going. In step five, time to bring in Ohm's law and express each current in terms of the voltages we just labeled. Quick refresher, Ohm's law says that current equals the voltage difference across a resistor divided by its resistance. Let's apply that to each resistor in the circuit. First, the 2-ohm resistor. The current I1 flows from the 10-volt node to V1. So we write I1 equals 10 minus V1 divided by 2. Next, the 8-ohm resistor, which connects V1 to ground. That gives us I2 equals V1 over 8. Now for the 6-ohm resistor between V2 and ground. That's simple. I3 equals V2 divided by 6. And finally, the 4-ohm resistor connected between the 10-volt node and V2. I4 equals 10 minus V2 divided by 4. And there you have it. We've got all 4 branch currents written in terms of V1 and V2. Ready to move on and apply KCL? Let's do it. Time to apply Kirchhoff's current law, KCL. But wait, there's a small snag. Both V1 and V2 are connected by a voltage source that isn't tied to the reference node. That's a problem because we don't know the current flowing through that voltage source. And without that current, we can't apply KCL to those two nodes individually. So here's the trick. When this happens, we treat both nodes on either side of the voltage source as one big node, a supernode. By combining them into a single supernode, we can apply KCL to the group as a whole without needing to know the current through the voltage source itself. Now let's write our KCL equation for the supernode. Let's add up the incoming and outgoing currents and set them equal. Currents I1 and I4 are flowing into the supernode. Currents I2 and I3 are flowing out. Substitute the expressions we found earlier. To make the math easier, we'll find a common denominator. Let's use 24. After simplifying, we get 3 times V1 plus 2 times V2 is 36 volts. That's our first equation. Two unknowns, V1 and V2, so we'll need one more equation to solve the system. And this is where the supernode comes to the rescue again. The voltage source connecting V1 and V2 gives us a second equation because we do know the voltage difference across it. It tells us V2 minus V1 equals 5 volts, our second equation. Now we've got a nice little system of two equations with two unknowns. And now comes the fun part. Let's solve for those node voltages. To solve this system of equations, we'll turn to some good old-fashioned algebra. You can use either substitution or elimination, whichever feels easier. Let's multiply the second equation by 2 and subtract it from equation 1. That eliminates V2 and gives us V1 is 5.2 volts. Now plug that back into equation 2 to find V2. V2 is 10.2 volts, and there we go. V1 is 5.2 volts, V2 is 10.2 volts. Nice and clean. Now we're ready to find the actual branch currents. Now that we've figured out the node voltages, all we need to do is plug those values, V1 and V2, into the current equations we set up earlier. Let's do it. First, for I1, that's 10 minus V1 divided by 2. 10 minus 5.2 is 4.8, and 4.8 divided by 2 gives us 2.4 amps. Next up, I2, that's V1 divided by 8. 5.2 divided by 8 equals 0.65 amps. Now for I3, we take V2 and divide it by 6. 10.2 divided by 6 gives us 1.7 amps. And finally, I4, that's 10 minus V2 divided by 4. 10 minus 10.2 is negative 0.2, and negative 0.2 divided by 4 gives us negative 0.05 amps. That negative sign just tells us the current flows in the opposite direction we originally assumed. Nothing to worry about. And just like that, we've successfully used nodal analysis to solve for every single branch current in this circuit. Even with a supernode in the mix, the process stays clear and manageable if you follow each step. And as you can see, a little bit of algebra goes a long way. That wraps it up. Even when dependent sources or supernodes pop up, the key is sticking to the method, step by step, and you'll get there every time.